May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Hi, I'm Minister Mardy Ringer, and thank you for joining us here at St. Mark Lutheran Church for another great Sunday service. Jesus said, "Give to the emperor what is the emperor's, but give to God what is God's." Our ultimate allegiance is to God and to service. I hope this service and sermon is a blessing to you. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, we have made idols of money, notoriety, different measures of success. Lord God, help us to know that you are the true reason of life. Help us to forgive ourselves. This is the time that we confess our sins to you and one another as we come to your altar, confessing together.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Live in God's ways, and know that God's grace and mercy is with you, now and always. Know that all of your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You know, Benjamin Franklin once said that nothing is certain except death and taxes. Well, in today's scripture, Jesus has to deal with death and taxes and his confrontation again with the Pharisees. You know, Jesus is simply trying to tell us in this scripture that what we do with our money is not as important as what we do with our lives.
Now, hear the gospel of our Lord as it is written in Matthew, the 22nd chapter, starting at the 15th verse down to the 22nd. And we say, "Glory to you, O Lord." The Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with the truth and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the taxes." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore the emperors the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away. This is the gospel of our Lord, and we say, praise to you, O Christ.
A lot. A little was overrated, and a lot was a little too complicated. Zero didn't satisfy me. A million wouldn't make me happy. That's when I learned a lesson
that it's all about your perception.
Hey, are you a pauper or a superstar? So you act, so you feel, so you are. It ain't about the size of your car. It's about the size of the faith in your heart.
There's hope. It doesn't cost a thing to smile. You don't have to pay to laugh. You gotta thank God for that. There's hope. It doesn't cost a thing to smile. You don't have to pay to laugh. You better thank God for that.
There's hope. Every time I turn on the TV,
there's hope.
Somebody's acting crazy.
There's hope.
If you let it, it'll drive you crazy.
There's hope.
But I'm taking back my power today.
Let us pray. Gracious Father, Lord, we come to you on bending knees, thanking you for another Sunday, Lord God. But most of all, Lord God, we thank you for allowing us to make it through another week, Lord God, and being able to come to your altar again, learning more about you, Lord God, learning more about ourselves, Lord God, and learning that we owe you, Lord God, everything. Knowing that we can't pay for our salvation, but we know that you are the owner of our souls, Lord God. So, Lord God, right now in this space, I ask you to minimize me, remove me, and utilize my body to speak to your people. Just allow me to be the instrument, Lord God. Lord God, we love you with all our heart, all our mind, and all our soul. In your holy name, amen. And as always, happy Sunday, St. Mark. Yep, happy Sunday, Saint everyone. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. You know, today's scripture lesson, it's about being put to the test again. And you know, at this point, you would think that these characters in the Bible that keep trying to entrap Jesus would know by now. I'm saying with his popularity and all the things that Jesus has already gone through, all the stories that they know about Jesus, it would make you think that they would say, you know what, we just gonna leave him alone. You know what I'm saying? They've tried him, even with the adulterous woman. saying, you know, they gave Jesus a stone and saying she has committed adultery. Let's stone her. And he asked them, well, whoever is here with no sin, you cast the first stone. Making them really reflect on themselves. And then later on, he even went to his own hometown and reading the scriptures in the synagogue, saying, in your hearing today, these scriptures are fulfilled. And they were upset and they wanted to throw him off a cliff. And he evaded them. He even was challenged by the legion of demons, where he cast out the demons into the swine and made the swine ran into the water and drowned themselves. Jesus even had a bout with Satan, the tempter in the wilderness, and it was not even a competition. And now we are back at it again. It's almost as if they're catching Jesus in a town hall meeting and want to ask him some political conversations to see if he's going to lose some of his supporters. Right now we are in a time where we are seeing a lot of politicians being asked so many questions, and each time they're asked a question, somebody is out there trying to catch them. And they have to think quickly on their feet. And a lot of times it's answers that if you say one thing, it's going to be against your supporters. And if you say another one, it's going to be against society or what the law actually may say right now. Right now, Jesus is in that kind of a situation where the Pharisees are coming to Jesus again. And they are teamed up with the Herodians. And, you know, you have one group that really don't care about taxes, don't really care about Rome and the emperor, but they don't like Jesus more. And then you have the other ones, the politicians that are real about pro-government in a sense. You know, a few years back, I remember when President Obama was running, and this was before his first term, and it was a bill that was on the floor. And they was asking if he's going to vote for it or against it. And he said, I'm present. They said, huh? You got to give an answer. And he said, that's my answer. I'm present. Right now, the Pharisees and the Herodians are coming to Jesus in that same manner, saying, is it lawful or is it unlawful for the people here to pay taxes? Jesus, knowing that this is a trap, that if he says, no, we need to pay taxes, that his supporters, who are against big government in a sense, will start looking at him in a different way. And at the same time, if he says, no, it's not lawful to pay, he know that the Roman government will start looking at him as a traitor or a person that they need to start dealing with. You know, it's funny. Jesus has already told all of these people. Y'all thought Solomon was the wisest. Well, the one that is in front of you is much more wiser than Solomon was. Much more educated than Solomon. But you still gonna try me. You know, it's interesting that the devil, the tempter, your adversary, never gives up. The adversary never takes a lunch break. The adversary doesn't, just because you're retired, doesn't mean he's retired. He is always on his job, trying his best to hunt after the prey. He is constantly trying to figure out how to trap you, how to catch you. You know, it reminds me of a conversation I had earlier this week with a pastor friend of mine, a Pastor Davis out of Augusta, Georgia, who's a lifelong hunter. My brother, he hunts everything from fish to turkeys, to deer, to squirrels. He's a hunter. That's what he does. We were having a conversation earlier this week, and he amazed me with all it takes, all the preparation that goes in to hunting. See, me, myself, I've never really been hunting. I've been fishing, but I've never been hunting. I'm saying, I used to always wonder, why don't you hunt a deer with a machine gun? Wouldn't it be easier? Just to... I'm saying that's me. And then he's like, no, that's kind of illegal right there. And then you cut up all the meat, you know, but that's just me. I don't know. I've never hunted. But with our conversation, he was telling me all the things that you have to do to prepare to catch that prey, that game. And each animal, each thing is a little bit different. Like with fish, you just got to really just put a pole or some bait in the water and the fish is going to really come to you. Because the fish is just like, ooh, food. And you can trap it and catch it. And then you have things like squirrels and smaller animals that you set up traps to catch them. You put little food and things that they are, that you know that they're attracted to. You set that up to easily catch them. But then you have more sophisticated game that uses their senses that are a little bit more difficult to catch. You know, I didn't realize a turkey is one of the hardest things to shoot and catch because the turkey's eyesight is so powerful and so in tune that they can see you blink for almost 100 yards out. They can see you blink and they say, okay, something wrong out there. But then he was telling me about the preparation of catching the deer. Where he gets up early and he scouts out the area. And he looks, because I asked him, like, how would you know where to hunt at? He said, well, you know, you got to look at where they always roam. If they're acorns and water, then that's a good primal spot. But it's more than just that. He's like, I gotta get up early. I got to bathe in a certain kind of fragrance. I can't use regular soap. I got to cover my whole scent. He said, it's even to the point when I brush my teeth, I got to brush my teeth with a certain kind of toothpaste because I don't want to give the wrong scent out because the deers, the prey, are in tune with the environment. If something smells off, they're not going to stay there long. If something sounds a little off, they got to go. And he said, I might sit there for hours on end waiting for that game to come. I want to let you know right now, you have a tempter. You have an adversary. You have devils in your life right now that are sitting there, getting there early in the morning, ready to catch you. Now see, some of us, we learn from our mistakes. But it's even more amazing to know that the devil and our adversaries learn from our mistakes too. And see, the only difference is they change. They say, okay, well, I couldn't trap him on that last thing, but I'm a trap him on this thing here. I'm a catch him where he usually goes to, where she usually feeds at. I'm a set some traps there. See, the devil knows how to disguise himself. And see, some of us, he knows that he can't just put some bait in front of us. No, this ain't that kind of saint. They've graduated from that. I can't just put a cage around them and they walk in. No, they got to prepare. The enemy is preparing every day, scouting how to trap you. But see, our Savior gave us not just animal sense, not just common sense, but he gave us some holy sense. You know, a Holy Spirit that comes with us that says something ain't right now. Something don't smell right in this atmosphere right now. Something ain't mushing right now. And we got to be able to know when it's time for us to get out of there. Some of us are so used to going to the same places, not knowing that these same places are the places that are setting us up to trap us. Just like here, Jesus already knew, oh, y'all are trying to con me into something. Y'all are trying to set up a little piece of bait. When they come to him and say, oh, good teacher. Oh, we know that you come from God. You only speak the truth. You're a good teacher. So let us ask you this question. You know, people will try to butter you up to set you up. People will try to uplift you just to bring you down. They do not have your best intentions. They just want to make you smile first. You know, just like if you ever got pulled over and the cop is like, hey, how you doing today? Where you been? Where you headed to? You know, you want to kind of talk and explain to him. He's not really trying to. He doesn't really care where you're going and where you're coming from. He's trying to see, what do I smell on you? These people, they're not on your side. They're not the friendly person. They're trying to get information about you. Now, I'm not saying that police are the devil, because they're not. They're good people and they're doing their job too. Just like, understand this, the devil is doing his job too. Now, I'm not saying he's a good person. I'm just saying he's on his job. You know, he doesn't take those vacation days like we do. Some of us, we like taking spiritual vacation days. Like I don't work for God for a good couple of 6 months. I've been good to everybody. But just this week, I just want to be myself. This week, I'm going to just take it off and I'm going to let my hair down. If you come at me wrong, I'm going to just give you a piece of my mind. I'm going to just take it off. But I'm sorry, that's a little sidebar, because we good Christians, right? We always keep the faith 24 hours, right? We never let the tempter sneak in, right? Yeah. Be glad that we have a good shepherd. Be glad that we have a good... just a sidebar. I don't know how many of y'all remember this. Some years ago, it was a cartoon that I remember growing up watching. And it was like an episode on Saturday mornings where they had this little sheepdog that was the protector of all of the sheep. And then they had a wolf that was always trying to capture and catch one of the sheep. And it was so kind of interesting and funny, because every morning the shepherd dog would wake up and the coyote would wake up and they both would clock in and they would set up their little camp places, and it would start. The coyote would go out and try to catch a sheep. And the sheepdog was always there at the right time to catch him. To, you know, foil his plan. And I remember one time the sheepdog had caught him by the neck and he was about to pound him, and the lunch bell blew. Boop! And he put him down. They went to his little corners. They got their little snack out and ate their little snack and put it back up and stretched and got back in place and back on the job. And they went to fighting again until it became the end of the day and they both clocked on out. You know, in that cartoon, it's interesting that the coyote never did the same trick twice. But he never prevailed either. You know, they remind me, that cartoon came back to my memory, because I feel like, you know, we have the great comforter that God put in place to always protect his sheep. Because you have in a tempter that's always trying to catch us, that's going to get there early in the morning, who's going to study the field, who's going to study you, because he is trying to capture and kill, destroy, break down everything that you have. But we have a guardian. We have one that is not going to be foiled, but we have to be able to tap into him. We have to be able to utilize him. We have to be able to listen to that spirit. Because a lot of times we will fail. A lot of times we do get caught by the tempter. And you say, well, God, what happened? What happened? This isn't supposed to happen. You know, I deal with this sometimes. I have little gadgets and stuff that regulates or let me know how my sugar level is doing. If you didn't know, I'm a diabetic. And every once in a while, you know, I have to always check and regulate my sugar levels and everything. And every so often, I will have an episode that I have to go to the hospital and they will evaluate me. And they always ask, well, what happened? And I have to tell them the truth sometimes. It's not the device that's messing up. It's the operator. I like to say it's the operator error. And they say, huh, yeah, it's the operator error. You know, that's the code where I am not using the resources that was provided to me the right way. And that's why I'm in this situation again. We do the same thing with Christ. We get into these situations over and over and over again. It's like, well, why, God? And he's like, it's an operator error. You're not using the Holy Spirit the way you're supposed to use the Holy Spirit. You're not utilizing it to make your life better. You're ignoring the signs. You are ignoring the symptoms. You are out in the wilderness ignoring everything that you see, that you smell, that you hear. You're not using your senses correctly. It ain't God's fault. It ain't the Holy Spirit's fault. You know the rest of that. Sometimes we have to eat crow. And understand that it is us and holding ourselves accountable. The devil is just sitting there laughing, saying, I got him again. First, I just had to put a little worm on the hook, caught him. Next time, I just got to put a little something in the box for them to pick up, and I got him. And sometimes they're standing away from a distance with a bow and arrow or a shotgun. Just ready for you not to pay attention, for you to get caught slipping out there. Jesus shows us that he is always ready, always having the Holy Spirit filled with him, that they cannot trap him. They cannot hold him back. They cannot trip him up because he is the great I am. And like he said, you can do the same things that I do. Actually, you're going to do things greater than I am. Because I am giving you an Holy Spirit. I am giving you a comforter. I am giving you the answers to the test. I'm giving you a cheat sheet for all of the tests that you are going through. So you can pass them over and over and over again and never get captured by the hunter. Because the hunter is after you. The hunter is still getting up early to catch you. Don't let him win. Don't let him win. Use your senses. Use those things that God has given you. Utilize that Holy Spirit. Listen. Use those spiritual senses. They kept coming to Jesus. Jesus kept prevailing. They continued to try Jesus until he was on a cross. They even tried after he was dead, buried. And when he came back, they still tried to, wait a minute, how can we find him? Let's grab his disciples. How do we find him and still prosecute him? They are never giving up. Don't think that just because you got your pension that the devil is like, okay, they won. No. Don't think that just because you got all of your kids out of high school and college and they got successful lives, that is, you can relax now that your race is over. No. The Satan is still after you. The tempter is still after you. It's like if you put your information out there saying you're looking for insurance, you know how they just keep on calling and keep on calling and keep on calling. Every company out there keep on calling. Hey, you need some good health insurance right now? And they just keep on like just a bill collector. They keep on. Well, understand the adversary is worse than that. He's going to keep on keeping on. But we have to do the same. Because greater is he that is in me that is in the world. We are greater than that hunter. We are greater than that adversary. You are greater than that person on your job that's trying to tear you down. You are greater than that person, that family member, that devil. You are greater. He's given you the tools to excel. Excel with it. He's given us grace. He's given us mercy. And understand that those are sufficient. Let us pray. Lord God, thank you. Gracious, gracious God, thank you. Protector of our lives, protector of our souls. Lord God, we thank you this day, Lord God. Allow us to utilize the resources that you have given us, Lord God, so we can always be protected and be vigilant in our surroundings, Lord God. Be observant so we're not trapped or caught or shot by the hunter, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for always holding our hands and guiding us through these pandemic times, Lord God. Gracious God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Allow us to hear your spirit speaking to us each and every day and throughout our lives, Lord God. Lord God, we love you and we thank you. In your holy name, amen.
The world needs a little bit of love today. Yes. Everybody needs love.
Yes.
So if you could just reach out, if you've been properly tested and quarantined for the 14 days, then reach out to your neighbor and just tell them I love you with the love of Christ. Give them a hug. Give them a little kiss on the cheek. And reach out to somebody at home or at work or at school this week. And just tell them that they are loved, because someone needs to hear it this week.
Yes.
What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little love. What the world needs now.
Love.
good for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross. Enough to last till the end.
Living in the gift of God's love and grace, let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. Let us pray. Lord of life, hear us as we lift to you our hopes and prayers for the church and the world. Let your grace empower us as people of faith to better serve you in the commonplaces of our lives. Grant that your Holy Spirit may so rule in our hearts that we serve you in holiness and purity and may give you continually thanks for your goodness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord God, we come to your altar praying for your presence in the world that is hurting and divided. Much of what we see is chaos and confusion and anxiety, a world that desperately needs to see your presence and your glory. Help us to trust in you, even when our world appears so dark and our troubles seem so large. Be with us as we go with the word and to the world as your people of peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, bless your healing power and place it on all those whose lives are broken in body, mind, or spirit. We lift to you, Lord, those names on our prayer list and those we now name in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And to your loving arms, O God, we entrust all for whom we pray, confident in your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Well, right now it's time for just a few announcements. Remember to check your Sunday bulletin for any additional ads and announcements. So just be sure to check those out. As always, we'd like for you to remember all those names you see listed on the screen. Many of our family and friends are in need of prayer and support during some really hard times. So let's keep them all lifted up in our personal prayers. May they feel the hand of Jesus lifting them up, holding them, and comforting them. We also have two birthdays coming up this week. We say happy birthday to Bryant McLemore, whose birthday is today, October 18th. And we also say happy birthday to Rose Lewis, whose birthday is October 22nd. Please remember to join us on Zoom for Bible study on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. We are continuing our study of the book of Matthew entitled The Promised King Comes. If you're interested in joining in the very lively discussion and study, please send your email address to stmarkchurchlutheran@gmail.com to receive the Zoom link. Now, in celebration of All Saints Sunday on November 1st, we're asking our members to send one photo of their deceased loved ones to be shown during the worship service. Please email your photos to stmarkchurchlutheran@gmail.com. Also, be sure to include the correct spelling of the names of the persons in the photo in your email. Now, during this time of tithes and offering, we ask for your financial support of this ministry, and we thank you for all the financial blessings you have given to this church. Your continued support helps St. Mark's ministry, reaching out to people where they are. So give through your online banking, Cash App, Venmo, or the good old U.S. mail. Jesus said, "Give to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and give to God the things that are God. All we have and all we are comes from God. So let us worship him with our offerings." Let us pray. We offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given to us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Since we are justified by God's grace through faith, let us confirm what we believe.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. This week, make sure you use your spiritual senses to not get trapped or shot or captured by the hunter. Go in peace and serve the Lord.